Hello, I'm W.T. Edmonson, and welcome to Focus. Freedom often causes unbelievable silence. Focus' intent, of course, is to inform, educate, and motivate our viewers to action. Well, I've been retired now for probably close to 4 years. But retirement can be rewarding, and it is for many. But for some, it is not so rewarding, and I fall in that category. I simply have not fallen into the comfort zone as far as retirement is concerned. My experience has been that if one chooses to retire, it is usually a relatively good experience. But if you're forced into retirement, then that can become somewhat depressing. You're not ready. For years, work becomes one's routine, day to day, week to week, month to month, year to year, life experience. We will be speaking with two individuals today who have made that transition and appear to have made it quite well. Our first guest is Mr. Clinton Buckhall, Lieutenant Colonel retired from the Missouri National Guard. He retired with 35 years of service. Then we will have our second retiree, who is Mr. Ben Clark. And so he will be coming up shortly. Lieutenant Colonel Buckhall, welcome to Focus.
Thank you.
All righty. As I indicated in my opening, that retirement transition can be something to deal with.
Yes.
But it appears that you've done a pretty good job at that.
I've tried. Yeah. I've tried to make it work. Yeah. Yes.
Okay. Tell us a little bit about, how you happened to, first of all, come to Lincoln University, but I understand that in high school there in the St. Louis area, you attended a very special school. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yes, in high school in St. Louis, when I was there at that time, they had about 10 public high schools. And my district was the Sumner High School, which is known as the DeVille. But as an eighth grader at that time, they took us to a tour of the newest high school in St. Louis. It was O'Fallon Technical High School. And I mean, it was so high tech. They took us to a tour there. As we drove in the buses, I saw an airplane. And I call, being a city kid, in a garage, now known as a hangar, but I call it the garage. And then as we traveled through and toured the whole building, things like cosmetology, IBM, drafting, blueprinting, pipe fitting, even they had a house that for carpentry inside of one of the buildings, another room doing plumbing and pipe fitting, things like that. And it was the high tech, but you had to make a test, had to pass a test to go there. So, of course, it was far away on the south side of St. Louis. And to go there, there was no buses that wouldn't take you out there or get there the best way you could. But you had to first take the test to go there, pass the grade. So I was able to do that. And I qualified to leave my district to go out there for that period of time. But it was rewarding for me. But, of course, it didn't last as long as they wanted to be in a technical school for with the test scores you had to make. So they changed the system again in St. Louis, where all the public high schools was able to send so many kids there because there were some cases where there were students that lived only one block away, could not attend O'Fallon Tech because of the test scores. Mm. So that didn't last long in the city. So then I moved there to my senior year. I followed my sweetheart at the time, and her district was Sodan, and so I followed her to Sodan at that time. Okay. But yes.
How did you happen to come to Jefferson City?
Well, my plans was when I finished high school there, since I did take plumbing, pipe fitting, and drafting up along with blueprint reading, to have my own construction company in St. Louis area. That was my goal. But I took the test twice to become a journeyman plumber, and I passed it twice. No one told me it would be so hard because of the that was the early, mid-60s, okay, to get into union. It wasn't the right time, they told me, as far as minorities getting to the union. Mm-hmm. But I took the test anyway and tried and passed twice, like I said. And even my senior year, I had enough of credits to graduate in January, so I did what they call co-education program. So I worked for a construction company my second semester, senior year. And come to find out, hey, I'm walking around reading blueprints to master plumbers who could not read blueprints. And so when I had to make a decision here, I couldn't receive their pay, but I could sure walk around and show them what they should be doing. So I decided to make a switch and said, well, if I can't do that side of my dream, just change avenues a little bit, and I go ahead and attend a university, a university, and I went into design and construction. And so I could further my education in that area so I can do some of the things I want to do. And so that's why I ended up in Jefferson City at Lincoln University at that time.
Mm-hmm. I understand that your wife, Pat, who was also employed with the Missouri National Guard, became very ill after a few years. That brought about some changes and some decisions that you had to make. Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, yes, when I got it, was after graduation, I became a member of the Missouri National Guard and was able to get a job there in the facility division as the facility inspector for the eastern section of the of Missouri. And during that time, I was a state employee at the time, and then I started applying for the federal positions, federal jobs. And when I was the director of safety and occupational health, she became ill. Yes, she was and she was ill for 20 years. And things you learn how to adjust your goals and your plans in life. But she was number one in my life, so I could easily adjust, okay, and make those changes. And with her, even through her illness, I learned so much. Through her 20 years, it gives you patience and how you learn how to be patient with not just with your coworkers, but other people too, okay. But she was there for 16 years before she came very ill, and she passed, 32 years of marriage until she passed away. And I continue on to work there, and it's funny how things change and begin to move, to revolve, as I call. I say certain things were my plans, the way I wanted to do certain things, but I believe now that it's God's plans, what He wants you to do, okay? And I had no regrets of all the changes I made and went on a different avenue, okay? Mm-hmm. And avenue at that time was in the human resource office that needed someone that could understand applications coming in from technical skill individuals. And I just happened to have qualifications for that. And as I entered that position, I just been moving from the staffing position, from position classification, writing position descriptions, and from retirement plans and service and benefits and every position in the HR office. I had over about a 25 year period. And I was able to touch many lives. Mm-hmm. And of course I say that God has plans, wants you to move different ways. And I know I wouldn't be able to do that in my plan, but no regrets. No regrets at all in my whole 35 years serving Missouri National Guard.
And now that you're retired, mm-hmm. You have gotten very involved in a special ministry at Second Baptist Church. Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, yes, I'm a deacon at the church, and with those responsibilities, you are involved in quite a bit of things. Name number one, you assist in the pastor, and whatever avenue he's wanting to get involved with. Or a suggestion that we may give to him that he thinks is a good idea and we can do it. And there's one ministry that we call the assistant home care, and for senior citizens mainly. And I saw the need for that, because every Sunday when we take communion out to our sick and shut-in at the church, I was visiting some senior citizens that may not have that visit maybe once a month. Someone come into their house, or let someone bring in wheels or meals to them, and they want to talk. They want to talk, and they would tell you about their concerns, and they need something done here and done there. And so I would come back to the houses, during the week, Wednesday, Thursday, and talk with them or see what that they may need some assistance with, things like that. So that started before I retired. Mm-hmm. But being working full time and within the National Guard with my command positions, I wasn't able to put as much time as I wanted to put into it. But once I retired, yes, this things began to develop. Some things I didn't ask for, and they just revolve. Mm-hmm. And it was just like a fit. That's mm-hmm. what I was supposed to do, okay? Spend more time in those, in that particular area. And since then, I've been able to help quite a few of our senior citizens in our church. And somehow with this community, the word gets out that okay, this person here knows something about Medicare or Medicaid, can help you with this. And I'm getting calls and I go help someone else, mm-hmm. and not even a member of our church. Yeah. But I don't mind helping, though, ma'am. You know, I have time for that, you know.
Yeah. One particular situation that you shared with me was a gentleman who was having some health issues, and you later found out the reason he was having some of these issues, he wasn't taking his medication.
Right. I visited him, and we were just talking, and he was saying about all his medication he takes, and he can't afford it. And I said, well, don't you know about the MOEX program, you know? And he never heard of it, and because he was not taking his medication because he had to eat, okay? Mm-hmm. And so I said, well, would you mind if I assist you with that and get the application and help you fill it out and all that? So we did that, and within about 45 days or so, he got his card in the mail. And he called me. He went to pick up his medication. He called me and said, listen, for the first time in a long time, I bought all my medication. Mm. And the cost of it was so minimum, he just couldn't believe it, you know. And it's things like that people just don't know about. And the only reason I know, I went over to those like social services, and since I'm going to help these people, I got to learn something about it myself. So I go in there and let them know that I'm not here to receive benefits. Give me some pamphlets and brochures, and I can read myself and learn more. And so now I met a couple of caseworkers over there. They know when I walk in there, they know I'm there for someone else, okay? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And so they don't mind helping me out and they give me some tips so I can get this done faster or whatever, you know? So, but yes, that's one of the programs that almost got cut this year, matter of fact, but they mm-hmm. still continued on. I'm glad they did for the senior citizens, mm-hmm. yes.
And I guess going through the situation with your wife over the period of time, you saw the need for
yes,
someone being able to assist.
Yes. You know, it have to be there. A lot of times I find out that there are people in the community, senior citizens, who don't have family members. And they live by themselves, and they may get, the old term, meals on wheels once a day. And that visit is the only visit they get all day. And sometimes that one person every day, all week. And for someone to come by and just check them out and see what they need, they may not need anything sometime. Just want to sit and talk, okay? And I go back for years because my grandparents raised me, okay? And you learn how to sit down, and I remember you sitting down with my grandparents and my great-grandfather, just sitting down talking, you know, talking. They want to tell you something. And if you sit down and listen, you may learn something, okay?
Tell us a little bit about, you have been an avid Red Cross participant for a number of years. Tell us about the Charles Drew program.
Well, that goes back when I was working for the National Guard. I became the coordinator for the blood drives in the Jeff City area for the National Guard. And I started giving blood because I look at it that we got approximately 10 pints of blood in our body, and I can give one. And within a short period of time, I'll get that blood back in my mm-hmm. system if I eat right and do things I'm supposed to do. And then I begin to learn that one pint of blood I was given, it could help save three lives, you know, with the red blood cells and the white blood cells, three lives. And that was remarkable to me, how my little pint can do that. And so in learning that and plus visiting the hospitals like I used to do, you know, like still do, and seeing that blood is needed, I pushed with the National Guard to have the blood drives, and we did. We have every 3 months, we're having blood drives. And with that, I was giving, and now, over that time, I didn't, when you start with that one pint, you never know how later on how many you'll be giving. I'm now, you know, in the 20-gallon club myself. And then someone told me about the Dr. Charles Drew club, and we all know who he is, you know, with the Red Cross. He's one of the founders of it. And that's where you can be matched with a child or an adult, someone with sickle cell anemia. And I said, wait a minute, so blood I'm giving anyway, I still help someone, not only in the hospitals or emergencies or whatever, but someone that really is living right now that need that blood. And they have to have blood sometime every 30, 45 days. So I really push that hard whenever I work now with the, I'm a volunteer with the Red Cross, and I work the blood drives here in Jefferson City. Not all of them, but most of them, you know, at least once, twice a week. And whenever I have the opportunity, I'm talking to someone to become a member of the Charles Drew, because they too, blood can be matched, and see what they can help someone with that has sickle cell anemia. Mm-hmm. So I just think it's a worthwhile, you know, new organization, the Red Cross, and what they do, and especially with the Charles Drew program. Mm-hmm.
Well, during a conversation, we were sharing that there's a tremendous number of young people that don't even know who Charles
no,
Drew is.
No. I was shocked, I think 2 years ago. I was here, I was given a presentation and to some young students, and later raised a hand up and asked me, you know, about him. And I was shocked she had no idea who he was, you know, to be an Afro-American as much as he had done, you know, to be one of the founders of the Red Cross, period, you know. We celebrate, we talk about Booker T. Washington and other black people that we know in history. He's just as important, you know. Without him, we wouldn't have known about transfusions of blood. Mm-hmm. And there's transfusions every day going on somewhere in the hospitals. Yes, it was shocking to me to hear from a young person. They had no idea who he was. Mm. And I said, well, history is being lost that way, you know.
Yeah.
Because it's no reason why it shouldn't, because it's so much out there that they can learn from him, you know, the things he've done. Yes.
And it was a tragedy as to how he died.
Yes. Yes.
You know, having developed that and was not even able to be a beneficiary because of racism.
I understand. Yes, that's true. That went to the wrong hospital, you know, at that time when he passed away in a car accident, and they wouldn't give him a transfusion, and he died because that the reason why he invented, okay, at that time. Yeah. You know, very sad.
Well, tell us a little bit about, now that our viewers have heard some of the things that you're involved in, the fact that you're very active, what would you say to individuals who are contemplating retirement,
mm-hmm.
who have already retired but haven't quite gotten in the swing of things yet? What would you say to those individuals?
Well, for those that have already retired, and number one, that TV gets old. You look at the TV, the stories on TV. Forget about that, okay? Mm-hmm. That's not it. Find something that they enjoy doing, if it's volunteer work, or if not volunteer work, or they love art, or they love working with audiovisual, whatever the interest could be. Get involved and do something. And even volunteer work, I have to say that there's always room to volunteer somewhere in that city. And for those who have not retired yet, they should start thinking about what they want to do when they retire. Mm-hmm. Don't wait till the day you retire and say, now I'm going to do this. Start doing it now if you can, or start thinking about it. Mm-hmm. You know? But just don't wait till that time that you're about to leave out the door.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Mr. Buckhall, thank
sure.
you very much.
Sure, okay, thank you.
Well, we'll be right back with Mr. Ben Clark, who is a local Jeffersonian, and he will share with us some of the things that he's been involved in. We'll be right back.
Here's a question for you. If you're only willing to use your safety belts part of the time, which part are you willing to give up?
You could learn a lot from a dummy. Buckle your safety belt.
Hello, welcome back. We are now with Mr. Ben Clark. He is a local Jeffersonian who grew up here, went away to the military, and then went out to California, and then chose to return to Jefferson City after retirement. So we'll be talking with him about the various facets of his life. Mr. Clark, welcome to Focus.
Thank you.
Okay.
Mr. Edmonds.
What was it like growing up in Jefferson City?
Well, it was very pleasant to me as a child. I started here in Jefferson City, and ironically, I lived here in 5 year increments. But I did go to nursery school here in Jefferson City, and in 1939, my parents and my family moved to Kansas City because of the war going on, and work was hard to find. So I lived in Kansas City until 1945 and moved back to Jefferson City in 1945. When I returned in 1945, I started here at the grade elementary school here, as a matter of fact, in this particular building. And I started at the third grade and finished through the eighth, and then went into the junior high school there at Lincoln University.
So during that time, if you were going to go through 9th to 12th grade, you had to go to Lincoln University?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Now, that was throughout this area, right?
That's correct.
Okay.
Yes.
There were no schools where blacks could go to high school?
No.
Other than Jefferson City?
No. As a matter of fact, they came as far away as Fulton and California, Missouri, and all the little towns in between to go to high school here in Jefferson City.
Well, we're going to talk about that. That'll be a different show. We'll talk about that in a different show. When did you enter the military?
I entered the military in 1950, June of 1950. We had just high school had just let out, and I went up there with a friend of mine to just go with him, and we both took the test, and I ended up passing it, and he ended up not passing it. So that's how I got into the military.
Okay. And how long were you in the military?
I was in the military for 3.5 years.
Okay. Any overseas duty?
Yes, I served in Korea in 1952 to December of 1953. I started in September 1952 to December 1953.
Now we'll touch on this, but we'll come back on this when we do our next show. Tell me, what was it like being a black in the military and going overseas? How were you received overseas?
Well, there was segregation. We were in our own units. The blacks was, although they were in the same building for the most part, the blacks, particularly here in the States, we stayed upstairs and the whites stayed downstairs. And then of course, in Korea, we were in a military, we were in a combat zone, so we just all mixed there.
And you've been retired how long?
19 years.
And you retired from what out in California?
I retired from the county of Los Angeles. I was with facilities management. For the first 18 years, I managed parking lots for the county of Los Angeles. And then they started a new program with facilities management, and I transferred into that. Mm-hmm. And I stayed there for 25 and a half years.
well, total of 25 and a half years.
California, Jefferson City. California, Jefferson City. Why did you decide to come back to Jefferson City?
Well, we had discussed it, my wife and I, and we wanted to get out of the city. We've been in the city long enough, and we had thought about going to various other states, and we concluded that we didn't know anyone there. And we also concluded that I had family living in Kansas City, and my wife had family living in St. Louis. And we had come back and forth from time to time visiting Jefferson City, and we saw how Jefferson City had changed, at least according to where you could live. Mm-hmm. And so we decided, well, that might be the best thing for us to do. If it was a small place, we could live with it and be close to our families within a couple of hours.
Mm, okay. You have a variety of hobbies and things that you do. And these hobbies appear to be very time-consuming. How did you happen to become interested in history and collecting?
Well, I actually first started collecting. After I got out of service and came back here, I got a job at the State Department and Sales Tax Division, and I was a mail clerk. And our job was to go to the post office and get all of the mail, and I was to open all of the mail. And I noticed on a lot of the letters there were different stamps. So I started tearing off the stamps and collecting those, and kind of got enthused about that. Mm-hmm. And I was surprised at the different stamps that there were just here in the United States.
Mm-hmm. What was your interest when you went to Lincoln University? What area were you more or less interested in?
Well, when I came back from the service, under the GI Bill, I went to graphic arts and printing under Mr. Lucius Jones. And of course, I wasn't going full time. And I probably went there maybe about at least 6 to 8 months before I started working steady for the mm-hmm. State mm-hmm. Department. Mm-hmm.
So your interest in history and collecting had nothing to do with your areas that you was interested in when you decided to go to school?
No, it wasn't.
Okay.
No, it wasn't.
Okay.
No.
And so when was that? How long have you been in the art of collecting?
Well, I would have to say probably 1954, and this was when I was working for the state, when I started collecting the stamps. However, when we did move to California and I started working for the County of Los Angeles, I was assigned at one time at the County of Los Angeles Museum of Art. And by being there, I was able to see a lot of artwork and see how it was put together and seeing the background of things that was going on. Well, there was a gentleman there that was a curator there, a black fellow that was in the art museum, and he and I started working together in black history events. We would do it at different churches and different events there in Los Angeles area. he always said, well, I had the know-how of how to do it, and he had the know-how of what to do it with.
Yeah. Tell me some of the things that you have began to collect over the years.
Well, after the stamps, I probably started out with guns and coins. And then I, as I say, black history after the turbulent 60s. And there was a lot of history that was coming out that was unavailable to blacks. And I was surprised at the amount of information that was there. And I wanted to get as much of this information as I could and share it with others. And I started in my church doing it. Each Black History Month, I would put on a display, and then it got to the point where other churches asked and a few of the community centers around the area and things of that sort. And of course, working with him, he was an avid historian, particularly black historian, and it benefited me a lot.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so you went from stamps to guns to other things. Tell me some of the things that that you, if you look back in your collection, tell me some of the things that you have collected.
Well, I have a collection of Native American plates. I got those from the various mints, such as the Franklin Mint and the, I can't think of the other thing, but at least three different mints, and also Presidential Wheaton bottles. I came by there upon those by chance, and the Wheaton and the famous American bottles, and of course the Avon bottles. I started that collection in 1995. There was a little place up on the corner of Chestnut and High Street. It's now a restaurant, but it used to be a little sort of a used place, and I would go up there, and that's when I first saw my first Avon bottle that I collected, which was a car, maybe a couple of them at that time, and then I'd go there at least once a week, and I'd find different cars, and I think that the gentleman that was up there would hold back, and so I could come and talk with him, because I would stay there and talk with him for a while.
Now, I did not realize until I saw your collection the different type of Avon bottles that there are. That's a tremendous number. And all types, cars and people. And now, do they still produce collectible bottles?
Well, I can't say that for certain. I do remember the last catalog I got probably was in 2005. And in that catalog, I saw four more cars that were put out in 2001. But I haven't been able to find those cars yet. They do have catalogs that come out about every 4 to 5 years, or did. And because I understand that the person that did the catalog had retired, that lived in Kansas City. But at any rate, this is how I found out about the different bottles. When I first started collecting them, I would check the papers and see where they were having yard sales, and they would usually say Avon bottles, so this is where I would go. And they was having one on West McCarty Street at one time, and I went over there, and a gentleman said, can I help you? I said, I'm looking for the Avon bottles you advertised, and he showed me probably about 10 or 12 cars. And I said, how much are they? And he said, $1 each. I said, I'd take them all. Well, a few minutes later, he came back, and he said, well, I got some more. And I thought, well, I got excited, because I said, here come some more cars. Well, however, these were dolls, women dolls. And I told him, I said, no, I don't collect those. I said, I just collect cars. So he made me a deal. He said, I'd give them all to you. If you buy them all, I'd give them all to you for $10. So I bought them. After buying them, I understood that there was a catalog out. This was before I got a catalog. And I went to one of the local bookstores, and I found the catalog, and I purchased it, and got home and sent it, and it just, it was unbelievable of the Avon bottle, because I would say the catalog was approximately about 2.5 inches thick.
Wow.
With Avon bottles in it. And so it challenged me then to, you know, get other ones. And when you find a set of something, you want to complete the set. And at one time, I had all of the chess sets except about 4 pieces. Well, I'm proud to report now I have a complete chess set.
How do you go about locating others who are avid collectors? Understand that there's a process that you all use of trading back and forth. If you have something, a couple of things that they don't have, you all trade and stuff like that. How do you go about identifying those individuals?
Well, at the time, for a while there, I was subscribing to one of the Avon papers that they had, and they had clubs all over throughout the United States. And they would let you know when they were meeting and when they were going to have a show, and then some advertisement was, some they had bottles to sell and others they had for trade, so I would do that. And then I'm not a computer person, so I don't get on online to find anything, but I ask my wife to, and sometimes she will. And I see them on there also.
As you think now about your time in retirement and your hobbies that you have developed over the years, have become more than just a hobby. It has almost become a way of life for you. Mm-hmm. What would you say to individuals who are contemplating retirement, or individuals who are in their early retirement? What would you say to those individuals of making their life enjoyable and fruitful?
Well, I would recommend to them that, get something to do that you like. There are so many things out there to do. From time to time, I speak to our senior citizen group at our church, and I tell them about the various opportunities that they can just invent for themselves. I'm kind of like the song that, I forget what the gentleman may name that wrote it, but it was about, I'm a man of means by no means. Mm-hmm. And I like to take nothing and make something out of it. And I like to do it in a presentable manner, and that it would have some history behind it. I think that each of my collections, whatever it is, that it has a story. It has a very important story behind it. If I was to sit here and name you the different things that I collect, I probably would take the rest of the show. Mm-hmm. Because it varies, and it's depending on what would interest me at the time when I see it. I've been introduced to, when I started the wheat and bottle collection, it was just by chance. A friend of ours from California came out and visited with us, and she was impressed with the Avon bottle. I had all but one particular bottle at that time, and when she left, she said she'd see what she could do. And when she left, about 2 weeks later, I get this package in the mail, and again, there's my bottle that I've been looking for a long time. Plus the first, it wasn't the first one I saw, but the first one that I owned was the Wheaton bottle, which was the George Washington bottle. And I remember seeing some at the Antique Mall on Missouri Boulevard. I immediately went down there and bought those there, and I've been looking for them. So I claimed about four of the bottles, so that made me have five at that time. And now I'm up to 27 bottles total with both collections.
Yeah. Well, Mr. Clark, you have definitely utilized your time in retirement well. Something that excites you, and also it is beneficial to the general public that see your displays. It's a very nice production. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
We'll see you next time. We hope that those of you who are contemplating retirement, those of you that are in retirement, that you take note, make yourself useful. TV, it's a waste of time. We'll see you next time. God bless.